Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining today's webinar. My name is Alexis Batoulis with Columbus, and today we have a special presentation for you on three ways food processors can benefit from Columbus Food. We started the call by putting everyone on mute, so if you have any questions during today's presentation, please use the question box on the upper right-hand side of the screen to ask any questions that may come up. At the end, we'll have time for a Q&A with our presenters. Finally, we are recording the session and we'll be sending a link of the recording to all attendees within an hour after this webcast. Now I'm excited to hand you off to your presenter today, Rahir Hussain.
Thank you very much, Alexis. My name indeed is Rahir Hussain. I'm officially from the Netherlands. I'm here today with Jan van Gulik. I am the sales and partner manager for To Increase. To Increase is a Columbus company. I am commercially responsible for our business central practice, which means that I work with our partners around the globe to sell, implement, and support our software. Jan van Gulik is our product owner, who is very familiar with everything that has to do with our food solution. I will give you some general information, an introduction of who To Increase is, how our customer base looks like, that sort of things. And then Jan will dive deeper into our solutions. He will highlight two of the features that we have, and he will give three short feature demos. Because time is short, we cannot do five feature demos, but we did want to show you a little bit about our application. And like Alexa said, then there is time to ask your questions. If you are already anxious to ask some questions, feel free to put them into the chat box so that we can pick them up right after we've done the presentation and the short demos. So for those who are not familiar with To Increase, like I said, To Increase is a Columbus company. We are actually the software house of Columbus, which means that we develop, maintain, and sell software around the globe on behalf of Columbus and together with Columbus. So by separating these two duties, what we can do is we can solemnly focus on building software, on delivering software, and to make sure that we get that updated. What you see happen a lot of times within organizations is that the reseller and the software development company is actually the same organization. And what happens then is that sometimes you get conflicts of interest, and software development is deprioritized or upgrades are deprioritized. But by separating these two entities within the Columbus Group, what Columbus has established is create an organization that can focus solemnly on building that software, deliver new releases, add functionality on top of the standard industry-specific solutions that are built. So that's why To Increase is a separate brand. We have over 170 employees within the To Increase office. To Increase is working out of the Netherlands, where they have the headquarters, but we also have more than 10 people in the States that are on our payroll. We have people in India and in some other countries around the world where we've found good people that wanted to work for To Increase. So we are indeed a global company working with a lot of people that are passionate and dedicated to build customer industry specific software. We have 2,200 customers actively using our software and are on some kind of enhancement plan or subscription, which gives us a pretty strong basis to work from and to further extend our solutions. We are very proud to say that we are listed as ISV of the year more than three times now by Microsoft, which basically means that we are very important for both Microsoft as well as the Dynamics ecosystem where we have been part of for more than 14 years now. If you would like to know more about To Increase, feel free to also ask your questions about that. Today we will focus on our business central practice. So we're not focusing on finance and operations, but to give you kind of a feel for what we have to offer for the two increased solutions for Business Central. We have a food manufacturing and distribution solution. You probably know this as Columbus Food. So we're going to talk about that extensively today. But we also have an engineer-to-order solution for project-based manufacturers. And we have some standalone solutions or complementary products, if you will, around quality management as a standalone solution, PLM integrations, which are part of the product engineering suite, but also a warehouse scanning solution and an integration platform, which we call Business Integration Solutions, in short, BIS, which allows you to set up master data structures, map towards EDI vans, and also to set up connections with third-party applications. Having said that, this is a slide that you might know from the past. If you would look at our traditional setup of solutions, we have had a core solution. We had a manufacturing process manufacturing module. We would have a warehouse and distribution module and some smaller solutions that you could build on top of that. So this is traditionally how you've known the two increase solutions. If you would look at what's in the core solutions, that's where we have added some of the fundamentals for anybody who works in food. For instance, we've adjusted the unit of measure tables to pounds, gallons, liters, those type of standard weights. But we've also added things around lot tracking. We've added things around allergen management. These are typical things that are not part of your vanilla, as they call it, or your base Business Central. So those are things that we have adjusted. In the manufacturing piece, we've added a lot of options that you can use to address your specific manufacturing scenario. And Jan will tell you more about that later on. And then we have warehousing distribution, where we see that we've added a lot of functionality, which makes the life easier for food companies that either only do distribution or they do manufacturing and distribution, where we've added things like container tracking, but we've also added first expired, first out picking, those kind of things to really make sure that any food type of company can actually be successful in implementing our food solution. So besides that, we have quality control, maintenance management, a lot of features that are adding value to our customers' lives. However, this is the old way of putting it. What we've done now is we've said we have AppSource and we have the SaaS platform. So we will make our offerings a little bit easier to understand, where we have a food distribution and a food manufacturing offer for the food food market. So if you would go to AppSource and you would type in to increase, you would find our offerings there as well. Today, we want to basically zoom into the food manufacturing piece, where we have three SKUs. We have the basic, the extended, and the advanced. So everything that we will demo today will be demoed out of this food solution. And you will see the advanced version that we've taken, where we basically have added all the options that I've showed you in the previous slide and made that part of this offering, except for some small solutions. So if you would have more questions about that, feel free to also reach out to your Columbus sales representative, as they know all about these solutions. What we would like to do and what we want to help our customers with is, it can be basically defined in three things. We would like to help you to build a reliable brand with consistent quality, because we know that it is pivotal for any food company that at all times they protect their brand, and that they have a brand which stands out by the quality that they have to offer, and by the products that show the the excellence that has been displayed by how it's processed, how it's brought to market, and how it is actually shown on the shelves of the retailer. We also would like to help with synergizing your sourcing and your logistics part. So we know that it is pivotal, again, to make sure that you know at all times where your lots are, where they've come from. So we want to help you to basically trace your lots down the chain and up the chain, and make sure that even in production, you know exactly where all the things and the raw materials are coming from, where they're going to, and where they are at. So that, for instance, if there would be a possible recall of your goods, you know exactly where they are. And of course, we also would like to help you to meet productivity and quality standards. And the way we want to do that is by offering you different types of options to facilitate production. Again, that's something that that Jan will tell you more about today. Then the way we see the value chain for any food processor slash manufacturer is basically sliced up in six pieces. We know that recipe management is very important. At all times, you know what your allergens are that are in the product, but you also want to see if you would tweak your recipes, what will be the impact on production? Will it optimize your production? What will happen? Those are things that you can also deal with, for instance, if you deal with recipe management with the 2-Increase solution. We know that food and is a very competitive market, so we want to help you by offering you different pricing strategies, by offering you different ways to set up your contracts with your vendors. So we offer a lot of flexibility there as well. Again, the sourcing and the production piece, I already explained that in the previous slide. And then quality, where we do a lot to help you to not only register quality, but also make sure that throughout the process you can do things to put things into quarantine, but also to make sure that you can take sample sizes of your production process, those kind of things. And then, again, the logistics piece, dealing with delivery trips, dealing with optimizing your routes in the warehouse, a lot of things that we have added to Standard Business Central to make your life easier. Having said that, today we want to zoom in into two things which we call highlights, which is co-product and byproduct and recipe management. Jan will use a slide and he will show you a little bit more about what we have to offer there. Because of time, we cannot double click on that by doing a demo and extensively discuss this. But we did wanted to highlight it to you because we think it might be applicable to what you want to do. And then we are going to do three feature demos around production planning and the options that we have to offer there, a quality control and lot tracking. So without further ado, Jan, I would like to give the word to you.
Thank you. Yeah, what Rogier already introduced is I would like to give some highlights regarding the food functionality in combination with Microsoft Standard Business Central. Yeah, when we are looking at manufacturing, we will see that although Standard BC has a lot to offer, there are some functionalities missing. If we are looking at the standard of BC, what we see is that you have the possibility to define production bombs, you can define routings, and from that setup, the next step is that you can create production orders which will be executed on the shop floor. These features are ideal for discrete manufacturing companies, but they do not really fit the way we see that process manufacturers are working. So what we have done is we have introduced some extra functionality on top of Business Central. Now, the basic manufacturing functionality that is available in food manufacturing and distribution has been developed to address the need for companies like you as a process manufacturer. And in some instances, existing BC features we have enhanced to provide more streamlined dating processing experience. What we will see is that what we have introduced extra functionality on three major stages. First of all, that has to do with the process definition. The production processes used as a manufacturer, we can see that some companies are producing intermediates and producing finished goods. That's a really important concept we have introduced in BC. Yeah, that's regarding our recipe management. I will highlight that in my next slides. What we also have added is extra functionality regarding planning and scheduling options. So that's really on top of BC. And we have introduced some extra functionality on the execution and reporting. The user can record the results of that production process to have that better better functionality in place. So that's what we have added on top of BC. That's what we would like to show you in the presentation. I do not have that much time to introduce the recipes and, for example, the co-byproduct products. So that will be done in PowerPoint. And the three layers below, which are also important for process manufacturing companies, like the production planning options, the quality control, and the lot tracking. That is what we would like to demo in the PowerPoint, or not in the PowerPoint, but in real life. If we are looking at the formulas and the recipes, what we see is that process manufacturers make products according formulas or recipes. Now, the production process usually involves all kinds of mixing, blending, batching, or cooking activities. What we see is that various ingredients or various raw materials come together, are mixed, are blended, are batched, are cooked, and the result is that there will be a new output product, but that is not really inseparable of all raw materials which went in. Now, with the basic process manufacturing, we can start defining a formula, and to start that formula, we define what the intermediate is, or the work in process item. And once the formula is made, it is usually packed into a finished good. And for that finished good, we see that as a more discrete item, because that's really defined on a unit base. And for this, we are using the packaging BOMs. So, for example, let's take an example of a certain barbecue sauce. We put all kinds of ingredients as a formula in a production BOM. The result is an intermediate, and that intermediate, the sauce itself, is packaged to a finished good. But that intermediate can be packed in different jars. I have, for example, a jar of 1 pound and 0.5 pound. You can package it in different sizes, but that's important that you also can plan it in different ways, and that's what we would like to show you afterwards. So that's one side of the product, that we can define formulas and packaging bombs. Another option what we see a lot in the food industry is that we are talking about co and byproducts, and if we are talking about a co and byproduct process, what we see is that there is a single there's not a single output item, there are multiple output items. Now you can see that we start with a single production order most of the times, and that single production order does have a particular raw material, and that raw material can be processed in different co-products. So that are the products which we can package to a finished product. But it can be that during that production process, there are also some outputs which are for you secondary products, but that secondary product can be used in other production processes. So the byproduct in that case does have a certain value for you as a company, so you can do something with it in other production processes. But that's really an important functionality we have introduced. As an example, we can, for example, name that the raw material could be potatoes, for example, and these potatoes can be processed to cut in pieces to fries. But it can also be that it will be cut in slices, and that these slices will end up in chips. So that's an option. Another option is, for example, in the meat industry. So when we start with a beef carcass, and that beef carcass can be processed to different pieces of meat which you can produce from that carcass. But there can also be some byproducts which you can use in other processes. So that's really the basic, the what we have added in our food solution regarding the product design functionality of the manufacturing part. The next step is that I would like to introduce as well the production planning and the production reporting options. And if we are looking at planning, there are several ways of planning your items. Now, first of all, for example, what I was talking about, the vendor supply. Now then we have we're talking about supply driven planning. Now this supply driven planning is most of the times used for co-product and byproduct functionality. And this gives the production planner the ability to create production orders based on the current availability of your production materials. So based upon the carcasses which have been delivered by your vendor, that carcasses are the starting point for you to plan and to see if you can meet the demand which have been created the demand can be from sales orders and can also be part of becoming from your forecast production schedule. So supply-driven planning is used for the co- and byproduct functionality. If we are looking at the stock level, supply and demand, we see that a lot of companies who are working make-to-stock, so production planning for make-to-stock items is used for this. Is used by using the Quick Planner and a daily production planner. The Quick Planner assist the manufacturer in ascertaining the production requirements by providing the user visibility of what is on hand, what do we have in stock, and what is the pending supply and the demand. And based upon these this information, the user can the system will provide an advice what to produce, but that advice can of course be corrected by the planner himself. The third option we have is regarding batch planning, and the batch planning is used for a lot of make-to-order processes. And if we are looking at the batch planning worksheet, if you open that batch planning worksheet, that batch planning will you also assist you in making decisions how to optimize the usage of your equipment. So, for example, to produce the example I gave to produce the barbecue sauce, it might be needed that you need to process that by using a kettle. And you put all the raw materials in that kettle and you start your production process, and afterwards the finished goods will be packed to the jars or to your finished good. But it might be that for a particular production run that you need that machine, that equipment, but you want to optimize the usage of that machine. So if you have, for example, to plan a batch, and you're not using the full capacity of that kettle, then you can make decisions on, do I need to produce some extra materials, and what can I produce extra, and how could I pack that off in different package sizes? So that's regarding the planning options. I would like to show that you that in the system afterwards. And for all activities, important to know as well is that we also have pre-process activities. We can plan pre-process activities, and for example, these are activities you need to perform before you really start your production. Now that can be, for example, that for a particular meat you need some blend of spices, and before production you need to produce these spices. But it can also be a particular flavor for syrup. It can be that there are some ingredients you need to use which are in the freezer, and they need to be the frozen material you cannot produce that use directly, so it is necessary to get them out of the freezer and to thaw them before you can use them. These are really pre-process activities. The next step is that I would like to, I will go out of the presentation and I will start the system. And as soon as I start the application, I will start the application as a business manager. So I see all the activities which are linked to my role. And what I did as well is I have opened the system as a production planner. And for the production planner, I'm able to see the pages which are really really set up for a production planner. And what we said over here, we can see the different options. What I would like to show you right now is if I start, for example, the basic planning, I can use the quick planner. This quick planner is used for the make to stock processes. So if I generate a quick planner worksheet from here, I can make my decisions. The system will tell me, okay, this is what my suggested quantity is, and what the date is that I require these materials. And based from this, I can start doing my planning. What you can see is that there is a certain safety stock could be set up. There is an availability calculated, but by the system, I can see what is already on hand, what's in stock, what is my demand, and what is the orders which have been created. This demand is based upon the forecast in the sales order, and what is in what is already processed, I can see that in my production orders. So these are columns I showed you. I added to this page. Now you can decide: do I need to plan on demand and orders? Then these two columns are enough to make my decisions, and from here I can do my planning. That's up to the user. As soon as I make my decisions, the system makes a suggestion how much to produce, and from here I can start making the real quantities. I can fill in the real quantities I would like to produce, and what the due date is when I want to produce these. When I want to schedule these production orders. As soon as I have entered my data, let's say that I'm going to produce 15 of this and that I want to produce that on the 17th, from here I can press the button create orders, and at that moment a production order will be created. This is the easy planning for your production processes. To make it a bit more complicated, we also have, decisions which the system can guide you with, so support you making the right decisions. You can use the batch planning worksheet. If I press the batch planning worksheet, what we will see is that the system comes up. I can create from here a new calculator worksheet again. And if I do calculate the worksheet again, I can make a decision how much days I would like to see ahead. Right now I can plan 5 days ahead. And from here, I can see that these are the items I'm able to produce. So these are the intermediates, there is a need. And these are the finished products which I can plan. If I take, for example, this yogurt, if I would like to plan this yogurt, I can make a decision from here on which date I would like to plan. Now let's say that the production plan is for tomorrow. And the next step is that I tell the system, okay, I would like, I would like to plan this item. At that moment, you can see that the system is trying, it does know, okay, you want to produce this finished good, but to do this, you need a particular intermediate. And that intermediate is my yogurt. And that yogurt can be packed in different sizes. So in this example, I have three different plain yogurts. Each and every intermediate is using 2 kilograms for this intermediate. I do not have a variation in the kilograms itself, but it doesn't matter. So I can plan 3 different items, and to plan this, I can make a decision. Okay, I would like to plan this item. I would like to plan this item as well. And this item is the same intermediate I'm using. To do this, I would like to use this production center, this equipment. And let's say that I'm going to plan, I would like to produce 500 of this item. I would like to produce 200 of this one and 50 of this one. What you will see is that the system is calculating, because I set up this equipment that I would really would like to plan for a batch size of 1,000. I'm not able to produce this by one production run. I need 2 production runs. So I have a total capacity of 2,000 at this moment. But to produce these finished goods, I have a required quantity of 1,500. So the system says, okay, Jan, if you want to plan to make a really usage of your equipment, you can produce 500 more intermediate. And by having this intermediate of 2 kilograms per item, I can produce 250 extra of this item, 250 extra of this item, or 250 extra of this item. Now let's say that I make a decision that I'm going to produce 150 from this one, then the system says, okay, then you have 150 to spread. Let's say that I'm going to produce 300 of this one, and then it ends up that I can produce 550 of this one. So I can make my decisions how I can make optimized usage of my system, of my production materials. I would also like to make an example by using this production process, because that I'm set that one up as well for my quality control and for my lot tracing, which I'm going to explain in my next presentation, in my next demo. So I'm going to to plan this item, and let's say that I'm going to produce, I would like to produce from this item, and I don't have multiple package variants from this one. Let's say that I'm going to produce 50. System says, okay, then you have a usage of 1250, and I can change that because I have a maximum order quantity of 17. So I can also make it a decision that I want to produce 1,700. Then the system says, okay, you can produce 80 more, and let's do that. I'm going to produce 68 of this beef balls, and I'm going to create a released order. and that released order I want to remember, because that's the one we are going to use in my next example. So this is regarding the functionality we have in place for the planning of my production. We also have introduced some extra functionality on the reporting. So if I'm entering my batch reporting functionality, so this is the at the end of the production that we can decide. So what we will see is that I have my Italian meatballs. That's the one we have produced. And what we can see is that the system is by selecting this production order, we have created this the 68 cases of this beef balls. To produce these beef balls, I need this intermediate. So I need first to produce this quantity of raw material. And for the production of this raw material, I need these consumption items. And what you can see is that you can plan this directly by using the system. From here, you can post the consumption, you can post the output. And since these are related, the production of your intermediate, so that's I'm using the formula. And the next one is the packaging bomb. That's the one to package off my intermediate to my finished product. Now, what we have introduced as well is functionality that we know exactly how much ingredients went in when starting my production. That's this functionality. So I know exactly what I put into my equipment. And at the end of the production line, we know exactly how much output we have produced. But there are situations that you do not know how much intermediate you have processed. By making decisions from here, you can balance your intermediate, and it can be either to your output or to your inputted raw materials. So then you can make your decisions on where to post the differences. Is that posting done on your production for the intermediate, or is that done on the production of your finished product? Then I would like to go on with the quality control. And before I'm going to demo the quality control, I would like to give you a short introduction of this functionality. Now, if the quality control module is really food module we have created as to increase. It's not standard. It's not based on the standard of BC. Of course, it is. It's coming. It's linked to the standard, but it is. If this is what we see, this is a very important for process manufacturing companies, and it allows a company to create quality tests against manufactured items. So, for example, the meatballs I have created, but that can also be done based upon raw materials, you received from your vendors. And by setting up some quarantine procedures, you can establish that that you can prevent the release of certain items until the quality control has been completed and has been passed. So that will prevent you using some raw materials in your production process, or on the other hand, it will prevent you from sending using your finished products to ship them to the customers. That's regarding the introduction. Of course, what we can do as well is that at the end of that procedure, we also have the possibility to report and to document these quality results in a certificate of analysis, which can be sent to the customer. I will go back to my And I would like to start the quality control by using another role. Right now I have the role of a quality control person, and as soon as I see my control activities, I have open control activities, and from here I can make my my entries on to see what I need to test for particular items. I can see, for example, that there is a pending test for I have a production of, or a usage of a receipt of eggs. These are sent from my vendor. If I click on this quality result, you can see from here that I have the possibility to define what the results are for this testing. Now, in this example, I have I can decide what the breed of hen is. Now from here I can do a lookup, because I can see the type is lookup, and from here I can select what the result is. And in my setup I have defined that for this item, my item F4100, that it needs to be white leghorn. If I click, for example, Rode, you will see that there will be a fail. And as soon as I select the correct value, I can see that there is a pass. The egg color, this is that's white. Is it organic? That's a Boolean. Is a yes or a no? And let's say it's yes. And from here, I can enter my storage temperature. And if I enter a storage temperature, for example, of 51, it will tell me, okay, Jan, that's not correct. It will be a fail. Depending on your setup, you can also decide that a retest is needed, so that or a retest is possible. If I select retest, so if I press complete and I tell the system, okay, this is a fail, and I can set up the lot status. Lot status code, and the lot status code is important, because from the lot status code I can show you the setup. From here I can decide what I can do with this lot, and this lot is not available for sale, it cannot be used for consumption, etc. So from here I can make these decisions. You can see it's coming automatically, but that's because I have entered the fill. If I set the temperature, for example, to 45, it's a fill as well. Uh, 46, then I have a pass. And then I can complete my, and then you see that it's passed, and there is no lot status code, so it is available in my either for sales orders or either for production runs. This was regarding a purchase receipt. If I have a look at items which I have produced, I can see from here the meatballs. I have already have created an example. You can see as well that after the production run, this is a quality control is created, and from here I can see that I have different values which I would like to test. The result, the functionality is the same. So it's an item, you set up your data collection items that will be linked to your item, and from here you can make your decisions, and based upon your boundaries you can have your you can have a pass of a test, it can be a suspended test, or it can be a fail of your test. And the result is of course important for you, what you can do with this lot. Now this information of the lot is processed of course in the database, and then I'm going back to my PowerPoint again, because this then the last part what we have introduced as well is the standard BC functionality provides some functionality regarding item tracking. So what we have done, we have enhanced the lot tracking functionality of standard BC. And this module, what we provide is it's a complete trail for lots. We allow that you can check from your raw material trace from your from receipt to production to sale, and but on the other hand as well, what we can provide functionality is that you can decide from your finished good which has been sold to a customer, that you can backward trace from that sale to the production and then to the components which were used to build that finished product. So that's what we have added in our lot tracking functionality. And I would like to show you that as well in the system. And what I will do is I will go back to my main page. In the main page, I have my lot history. And if I, from here, I can see all the lots which have been created in the past. And if I take, for example, this, I have received some meat from a vendor, and the vendor does a recall on this product. And from here, I can do a lot tracing. If I click on lot tracing, what we will see is that the system is starting a new page. I can see that from this lot, I have the information regarding the source. So from here, I can see that it has been purchased, and I can see which vendor, which document number, which receipt was linked to that. And from the lot number, of course. But I can see as well that from here, I can see what the destination was of this lot. So this is not a very complex situation. I can see that this meat has been sent after receipt to a certain location. So that is my main location. So it is still in my warehouse. But I can see as well that it has been used in a production order. So it has been processed to a finished product. And that finished product does have this lot number. And from here, I can start doing a new trace. If I want to know, I want to trace right now this lot. So if I press trace, you can see that I do a trace right now on a finished product. So this was the destination, but from here I can see what the source was, what went into these products. So right now I'm doing it backward. So it might be that this finished product is delivered to a particular customer, and when I'm looking at a particular customer, I could trace that back to my to this production order. And from this production order, I can see the raw materials which are used in that production process. So that's the other way around. And that brings me to the last slide. And I saw there was a text, any questions, but I missed that right now.
Now we'll take time to address any questions from the group. Please enter your questions in the chat box on the right side of the screen.
I see one question coming in with regards to availability. Which platforms is this available on? It's currently released on our latest on-premise version, Business Central 15.3 is our last release, and it's also available on our cloud solution, which is being released continuously. So on these two versions, this is available, and majority of this is also available on previous versions. And where we have a policy where we say we basically support whatever Microsoft supports. So everything that Microsoft currently is supporting out there, we are also supporting and still actively reselling on. If this happens to be not one of the versions you are on, feel free to reach out to your sales representative to see if we can do something custom for you there as well.
Good to know is that I was presenting in the cloud, Rogier.
Yeah. But that looks exactly the same as it does on the latest on-prem version, right?
That's correct, yeah. You can't see it from the outside.
All right, great. If there are no additional questions, I'd like to thank you all for attending today's presentation. Thank you so much, Roger and Jan, for a great overview of three ways food processors can benefit from Columbus Food. That concludes our webinar today. Thanks again, everyone. Have a great rest of your day.